Hey guys, so it's been a while, like 2 months type of while. I just wanted to apologize for my channel being so dead these like last 2 months or so. I've just been kind of busy with work, and also this is like the longest script I've written yet. It's like over 25 pages, which I mean, to a lot of you might not seem very long. But to me, it's pretty long because I mean, if you look through the rest of the videos on my channel, they're definitely like on the shorter side. So this is definitely one of my longest, if not maybe even my longest video. There's like five ladybugs. Oh my god. And that leads me to the next thing I want to say. I know that this is not a lost media video, as you can obviously see in the title of this video. And I'm still going to be making lost media videos, but for the longest time, I really wanted to make an iceberg video. So that's probably a big reason why it took me so long to upload, because like I've never made a lost or an iceberg video before. And I don't know, this script is like so many pages long and stuff. So and that leads me to the final thing I want to say, which is this is our new friend, Oscar. Oscar is going to be joining me in my videos from this point forward. I just found him at a candy shop, and I thought he was super adorable, so I bought him and I named him Oscar, and now he's going to be our little buddy on this channel. And so yeah, I hope you like it. So this is Oscar. Say hi to Oscar. So if you don't know what an iceberg list is, it's basically kind of like a tier list. So like the top of the chart or the tip of the iceberg consists of like these like tame, like well-known like facts or whatever type of topic you're covering. And then as you get more closer to the bottom of the iceberg, it consists of more darker, more obscure topics. So with that being said, I am going to be doing a Lion King iceberg video. So yeah, so the top of it will be like these like tame, more well-known facts, and then the bottom will get like darker, and a lot of them deal with like dark conspiracy theories and stuff. I probably explain that in a very bad way because I'm horrible at explaining stuff, but I promise you'll get the gist of it as we get into the video. I hope. So if you've seen the Disney animated film Hercules, then you'll probably remember the scene where Hercules is posing for a portrait, and as he's posing, he's wearing the pelt of a lion, and that lion pelt is a pelt of Scar. Now obviously there's a ton of theories as to why or how Hercules is wearing the skinned, lifeless body of a very beloved Disney villain. Now there is one theory I read online that states that once Scar was killed, a hunter came along and found his body, skinned him, and then gave his pelt to Hercules as like a gift. It's also believed by many that the pelt isn't actually that of Scar, but that the pelt is supposed to reference the Neman Lion, and that the animators just made it look like Scar as a little Easter egg. Now if you don't know what the Neman Lion is, apparently it's a giant lion based off of the actual Greek mythology story of Hercules, where he kills a lion and wears its pelt. Andreas Deja? Once again, I have no idea if I pronounced that name correctly. He was the supervising animator for many animated characters in other Disney films, and he was also the supervising animator for Scar as well. But he was also the supervising animator for Hercules as well, so this has led many people to believe that he just kind of added Scar in this just to have a little bit of fun. Now I feel this is the perfect opportunity to tell you guys that Scar is actually my favorite Disney villain, so no matter what the reasons are, I find it kind of disturbing that Disney just kind of took a very beloved Disney villain and made him into some type of lifeless rug in Hercules. Also, do you guys remember this scene right here?
He'd make a very handsome throw rug.
Yeah. Jeremy Irons, who was the voice of Scar, also performed the song Be Prepared, but his voice gave out after he sang the line "You won't get a sniff out of me," so Winnie the Pooh and Tigger actor Jim Cummings actually replaced Irons and took over for the rest of the song. So apparently the voice actors for Timon and Pumbaa, Nathan Lane and Ernie Sabella, actually originally auditioned to play hyenas. Now the story behind this is actually kind of funny. Lane and Sabella had both gone into the audition booth to read their lines together, and it was when they finished reading those lines that they started goofing off together in the booth. Lion King co-director Roger Allers saw them goofing off together, really liked their chemistry together, and figured they would be perfect to play the role of Timon and Pumbaa. So a lot of the inspiration from The Lion King actually came from the Shakespearean play Hamlet, as there are many similarities between the two stories. Now I'm just gonna lightly go over this topic because I have never read Hamlet, I've never seen any of the movies, so I know absolutely nothing about the story or its characters. So I'm gonna leave some links in the description below of some of the articles that I read when I did like the research for this in particular segment, so if you want to know more about this, then I'll have links down in the description below. But I'm just gonna lightly go over this, so please don't hate me. Both Simba and Hamlet have evil uncles that are desperate for power, and they both achieve this by killing their own brother. In The Lion King, Simba develops a close friendship with Timon and Pumbaa, just like how Hamlet forms a friendship with Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Although I guess it turns out that the latter works for Hamlet's uncle. I also have no idea who Hamlet's uncle is, but I guess he's like evil or something? I don't know, like I said, I don't know anything about the story. Just visit the links in the description if you want to know more. I'm trying, okay? So I actually didn't know this prior to doing the research for this video, but apparently almost all of the character names in The Lion King are Swahili names, so therefore they have like these certain meanings behind them. For example, Simba's name translates into lion in Swahili, which in case you're wondering why it's just simply lion, I think it makes sense because I mean he works his way up to be a lion, you know, the Lion King. Yeah. Nala means gift, as she gave Simba the gift of love and friendship. Mufasa means king. And while Timon's name does translate to respect, he is actually one of the few characters in the film whose name does not have any African origin to it. Timon's name actually has Greek origin to it. Pumbaa means slow-witted, which I think that says a lot about him right there. Rafiki means friend, as he's a great friend to the royal family and he's like serves as like great guidance to Simba and all that stuff. Zazu means movement and is another name who doesn't have African origins, instead being a common girl's name in Hebrew. And finally, Sarabi means mirage. Mirage? I think I'm saying that right.
Mirage.
Okay, I did say it right. Sarabi means mirage. We're gonna move on to the next topic now. Dude, it's raining so hard right now, like, I actually wonder if my mic is picking up. It's like so loud outside right now. So the scene in the movie where Timon asks, "What do you want me to do? Dress in drag and do the hula?" That was actually improvised by Nathan Lane.
What do you want me to do? Dress in drag and do the hula?
Roger Allers apparently liked that line so much that he actually decided to keep that line in the movie and make like a whole little animation scene for it. Now the scene was actually originally supposed to feature a Michael Jackson style song, but due to time constraints that unfortunately did not end up happening. Now I'm sure a lot of you guys would probably know that I would have loved to have a Michael Jackson song in The Lion King because, well, you know. Yeah. Just in case you guys haven't figured that out already. Warhawk Rhapsody was a song that was written for The Lion King but was later deleted from the film. The song was written by Elton John but was later replaced with the infamous song Hakuna Matata. It was released on the albums Rhythm of the Pride Lands and The Lion King The Legacy Collection. Warhawk Rhapsody was also later rewritten years later into the song That's All I Need for the film Lion King 1.5. The stampede scene is probably one of the most iconic scenes in film history, but what some of you may not know is that that scene actually took three years to animate. In an interview with one of the film's directors, Rob Minkoff, and producer Don Hahn, they explained that the reason why the scene took so long to animate was because it was a combination of like emotional depth and pretty advanced technology at the time. All the wildebeests in the stampede were actually computer generated. Obviously, computer generation was a very new technology at the time, so animators had to make sure that every single wildebeest in this scene had the proper looks and movements. So yeah, again, given that computer animation was pretty damn new at the time, it's honestly completely understandable why it took them so long to animate this scene, and especially given that this was around the time that Toy Story came out and everything, yeah, pretty understandable, I'd say. Now I trust that this next one is one that most of you are familiar with, as it's something that's been floating around the internet for quite some time now, and it's also just extremely hilarious. So in the original VHS release of The Lion King, in the scene where Simba lies down and like a big dust cloud flies up, in that cloud, you see the word sex start to form, or at least that's what a lot of people think. A lot of people also think that it's forming the letters SFX, meaning sound effects. But either way, no matter what this little message says, this was later removed in the DVD release of the film. Even though Rafiki is referred to as a baboon in the movie, he actually appears to be a mandrill due to the colors on his face. During the final scene of the movie, after Simba defeats Scar, Zazu was originally going to greet Simba with a Your Majesty at Pride Rock. However, the animators decided against this as they thought that the scene would be more impactful without dialogue. However, the line was cut after the scene was already animated, so you can still see Zazu's mouth move during the scene. However though, they ended up reusing the Your Majesty line during the 2019 Lion King remake.
Your Majesty.
Kimba the White Lion is a 1960s anime series that was written and illustrated by Osamu Tezuka. The show is about a tiny white cub named Kimba who is put on a ship after he and his mother are captured by hunters after his father is killed. When the ship gets into a wreck and kills everyone but Kimba, he swims for shore and grows up in the jungle with many friends. When Disney released The Lion King in 1994, they claimed that this movie was their first original story that wasn't based on an already existing fairy tale. However, after the movie's release, many claimed that The Lion King shared a lot of similarities to Kimba the White Lion. Similarities include Mufasa and Simba atop Pride Rock, and Kimba being atop something very similar to Pride Rock. Both cubs have their father murdered, while both have evil lions as the antagonist, both of which have scars across their eyes, both have evil hyena sidekicks, both have funny and crazy birds, and both have mandrills that are mentors. Once all the criticism for this started, Rob Minkoff stated in an interview that, quote, it was not unusual to have characters like a baboon, a bird, or hyenas. Minkoff and Roger Allers both stated that neither one of them were familiar with Kimba the White Lion during the making of The Lion King. Kovu is a young male lion who first appears in the film The Lion King 2, Simba's Pride. He is a mate of Kara, who is the daughter of Simba and Nala, and is the youngest son of Zira, who has two older brothers named Nuka and Mutani. Zira was a close and loyal follower of Scar, who gave birth to Kovu during Scar's reign. Kovu was picked by Scar to be Scar's successor and to be king of Pride Rock after him, and Scar was also Kovu's mentor up until Scar's death. Now, even though Kovu shares a very strong resemblance to Scar, and many would think that he is related to Scar because he literally looks like identical to him, he actually is not related to Scar. But Kovu was originally supposed to be the biological son of Scar. However, then Disney CEO Michael Eisner decided to scrap this idea because the relationship between Kovu and Kiara would have caused incest between the two as paternal first cousins. King of the Jungle was a very early version of The Lion King. It was the original name of the movie before the title was changed to the famous title that we all know today. During early treatments of the story, there were many characters created for The King of the Jungle, however many of these characters ended up not making it to The Lion King. The following is a list of some of those deleted characters. The Great Spirit. The Great Spirit was a mystical spirit that the lions of the Pride Lands worshipped. Batty. Batty was a bat-eared fox that lived in the Pride Lands and was childhood friends with Simba and Nala. Buzz. Set to appear in The Lion King 1.5, but was later removed from the film, Buzz was a meerkat that lived in Timon's colony. Tired of living in fear of the hyenas, Buzz decided to stand up for his colony and fought a hyena, but was killed while doing so. Kawashi. An early iteration of Rafiki, Kawashi was a male baboon. He was old and wise and helped Simba escape the hyenas after Scar killed Mufasa. He later teamed up with Simba to help defeat Scar. So many people believe that in the scene where Simba is talking to Mufasa's spirit in the sky, it's just Simba hallucinating it all, and none of that was actually real. It didn't happen. But also, many other people also believe that Mufasa really was in the sky, as Rafiki appeared to have seen him too in that scene. If you've seen The Lion King 2, Simba's Pride, then you'd remember the heartbreaking death of Nuka. As stated earlier in the video, Zira was a very devout follower of Scar and was very loyal to him even after Scar's death. Zero was the leader of the Outsiders. Now, the Outsiders were this group of lions that were banned from Pride Rock by Simba because of their extreme loyalty to Scar. So back to Nuka. Nuka is crushed by falling logs after chasing Simba in an attempt to kill him and dies by his mother's side. In a deleted scene, Nuka has an extended death scene where he says to his mother, "I finally got your attention, didn't I?"
Well, I finally got your attention, didn't I?
I honestly personally think that they should have kept this line in the movie because the entire movie up until this moment, Nuka is like never appreciated at all by Zira. Yeah, I told you things are gonna start getting pretty interesting. So last year, a TikToker by the name of Classy King Zero came up with this crazy theory that states that Scar actually ain't Mufasa's corpse. Now, a big scene that actually kind of backs up this theory is the scene where Scar has Zazu locked up in like a bone cage thing, and then Zazu starts singing about coconuts or whatever. And while Zazu is singing that song, Scar is seen picking up a skull. Now, many people think that that skull appears to be that of a lion skull, because if you look at pictures of lion skulls on Google, it looks like a lion skull. I'm just gonna be honest, dude. It actually looks like the skull of a lion. I mean, we never see Scar's body for the remainder of the film after his death, so I mean, honestly, who's to say that Scar didn't maybe eat his corpse or do something to his corpse? However, Mufasa's body could have easily have just been left where it was, left to decay and all that. Also, the scar that Mufasa picks up, while it could very well be a lion skull, it could just be the skull of a different lion. Maybe a lion that died by starvation, since they make it pretty clear in the movie that everyone at Pride Rock is starving, or it could have been a lion that could have died at the hands of Scar. But either way, this is an extremely dark but also a very good conspiracy theory, and I'd love to hear you guys' thoughts about it in the comments. So we all know how Scar dies at the end of the film, by getting eaten by the hyenas after losing his fight with Simba. But Scar's original death was actually much more graphic and disturbing. In the original ending, Scar and Simba are still fighting at the top of Pride Rock. However, Scar injures Simba, and this causes Simba to fall close to the edge of the ledge. Scar then lunges at Simba, and this then causes Simba to use his legs and push Scar over the edge. As Scar dangles from the edge, he reminds Simba that he is no murderer like his uncle, and Simba goes to save Scar. Scar then grabs Simba by the mane and throws him over Pride Rock. However, Simba's fall is broken as he lands on a tree. Believing Simba to be dead, Scar stands atop Pride Rock, laughing as the flames engulf him, burning him alive. Now, I know there are some Disney movies that came out after The Lion King that had the villains die in some pretty disturbing ways, such as Clayton getting hanged in Tarzan, or Frollo and Hunchback of Notre Dame literally falling into a pool of lava. But the writers for The Lion King decided that it was better for Scar to be eaten by the hyenas, as it would have kind of completed the whole circle between them. So I'm sure many of you have realized that during the song Be Prepared, there's a part where the hyenas are like literally marching like Nazis while Scar is elevated above them, clearly representing Hitler. This scene was actually inspired by a Nazi propaganda film from 1935, which was called Triumph of the Will. According to a 1994 article, Be Prepared, quote, grew out of one sketch by story staffer Jorgen Klubein that pictured Scar as Hitler. Yep, that's not dark at all. The Elephant Graveyard is a barren wasteland located just outside the Pride Lands that consists of the skeletal remains of elephants, hence the name Elephant Graveyard. It is also the home of the hyenas. Now, the actual skeletons in the film appear to be much larger than actual elephant bones, and the tusks appear to resemble that of a mammoth instead of an elephant, so that has led many people to believe that the remains we're seeing in this film are actually mammoth skeletons, as apparently some species of mammoths actually used to live in Africa. I guess, I mean, that's what Google said, so... Or they actually are elephant bones and the animators just decide to make them super unrealistically big because, you know, it's a cartoon. Okay, so we got another conspiracy theory, so you already know this one's gonna be interesting. So a couple years back, Redditor Combustible Compost posted a conspiracy theory that states Zazu actually secretly teamed up with Scar to kill Mufasa. So What's the motive? Well, according to the theory, Zazu is constantly disrespected by Simba at the beginning of the film, and Mufasa completely allows this to happen. One prime example is when Mufasa uses Zazu as a prop for Simba's pouncing lesson. The OP goes on to say that while Zazu is worried about Mufasa raising Simba to be a brat and therefore ruining the kingdom when Simba one day becomes king, he doesn't want Mufasa dead. Now you may remember at the very beginning of the film when Simba is just a tiny little cub and Zazu confronts Scar about not attending Simba's ceremony, and Scar says that he wishes to be king. Zazu later remembers his statement made by Scar years later when Zazu is completely fed up with Simba's behavior. At the conclusion of I Just Can't Wait to Be King, Zazu is left under a rhino as Simba and Nala make their way to the elephant graveyard. The OP states that Zazu could not have known about the two of them going to the graveyard since his task was to take them to the waterhole. So it was then that possibly Zazu went to Scar, who then told Zazu about the plan to get rid of Simba, and Zazu agreed with this as he was just so fed up with Simba's behavior at this point. I also found another interesting theory on a Lion King wiki made by Preston DVD, and this theory states that Zazu was the only one to know Scar's secret of killing Mufasa. The theory states that while Zazu was knocked out by Scar, he could have easily woken up in time to see Scar murder Mufasa, or he could have heard Scar tell the hyenas to kill Simba. This would explain Scar's aggressiveness towards Zazu, and it would also explain why he keeps him locked up throughout the majority of the film. Because he doesn't want Zazu spilling his secret. Okay, so at the end of The Lion King 2, Zira dies by clinging onto the edge of a cliff and then losing her grip and falling to her death. But her original death actually had her deliberately letting go of the cliff. So basically she commits suicide. But this was removed by the writers as they decided this was not appropriate and too adult for a Disney movie. However, it's still implied in the final version that she commits suicide because she appears to be smiling as she's falling. So here's something that may or may not surprise you. Scar and Mufasa aren't actually brothers. Not by blood at least. This was actually confirmed by director Rob Minkoff and producer Dan Hahn. As it turns out, in real life, lion packs typically don't have more than one male adult lion. The females typically outnumber them. Though occasionally, a rogue male lion will come and join the pack from the outside, and they will kill the current male leader if they sense that that leader is getting too old. The rogue lion will then kill the lion cubs too, asserting himself as the new leader of the pack. You could definitely say this is what Scar was doing. He simply joined in on the pack as a rogue lion, sensed Mufasa was getting too old, killed him, attempted to kill Simba, and joined the pack as the new leader. And I mean, even without knowing any of this information, it's kind of obvious anyways that they're not brothers, because I mean, they look nothing alike. I really hope you guys enjoyed the video, and as I said before, I'm really sorry I haven't uploaded in like 2 months. This channel's been dead for quite a long time, and I feel horrible about that. Now, the next few videos I plan on making will be a little bit different from what you guys are used to. That's not me saying that I'm done making Lost Media videos, or this will be even my only iceberg video. I will always make Lost Media videos because those are videos I really enjoy making. But I also just kind of want to branch out and make different types of videos as well, and just kind of explore my creativity a little bit, if that makes sense. I hope it does. And if you want to see what I have planned for this channel, then make sure to hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications, so that way you won't miss every time I upload. We're actually almost at 500 subscribers, which I mean, to me personally, it's quite a big deal. And I just realized that I haven't live streamed in like over a year. It's been like a year and a half or something like that since I've done any sort of streaming on my channel. So once I hit 500 subscribers, I'll do a live stream for you guys. If you have any video suggestions for me, then make sure to email them to me at bluephantomofficial@gmail.com. Or you could just send me a DM on Instagram or Twitter or something like that. I'll see it. I'll reply to you. So you could also do that as well. Okay, well, I guess that's all I have to say for this one. So I hope you all stay safe and healthy out there. And I'll see you all in the next video. And I promise it won't be 2 months until my next upload.